the green steel production. And before I move to the next slide, let me tell you what we mean by green steel. Of course, as you all understood already, that it doesn't mean that the color of the steel to be turned to green, but it is about producing steel without emission of any carbon dioxide. And that is how the environment emissions norm in India and abroad can be met. So in the next slide, I am in slide number two, where we are showing you the country-wise CO2 emission data. The total CO2 emission all over the world is about 36 gigaton per year, and 10% the 28% of this, which is about 10 gigaton, is coming from China because of their phenomenal growth in last few decades. The second is, of course, United States, which is about 15% of the total emission, which is 5.4 gigaton, as you can see from my slides here. And India is emitting about 7% of the total GHG of the world. And we are emitting right now about 2.65 gigaton per annum. In the next slide, I am showing you the Indian carbon dioxide emission and what are the different sources of this carbon dioxide in India. In India, the maximum of this CO2 is coming from the electricity and the heat sources, which is about 41%. 34% comes from different industries, where of course steel is another industry, and 13% is coming from the transportation. So you must have heard a lot of discussion about the car being electrified. That means we are using battery powered cars or fuel cell driven cars, but that will solve only 13% of the total problem. The big two chunks are the electricity generation and different industries. Within the industry, if you see now the right hand side pie chart, you will find that steel is responsible for about 8.5% of the total emission. So, which is quite large in India, and in the world, it is about 7%. So that's why the steel companies across the world are trying to minimize this emission as much as possible. I'm moving to the next slide, which is having a title of Context of Net Neutrality. I hope you can see this slide. Any of you could tell me, please?
Oh, yes, sir.
Yes.
Yes. Okay. So let's talk about what is the net neutrality. You would be hearing this term a lot nowadays, and this is related to the Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change, or IPCC. They have come up with such a term, and they have given us different pathways, which you can see in the right hand side plot over here. So the representative concentration pathways are the different ways that IPCC has envisaged the scenario in the world could change in terms of the GHG emission. The best possible scenario is given by this green line over here, okay, which talks about that the temperature of Earth or the Earth's surface will increase by about 2 degrees Celsius by the end of this century. And that is understood to be a bearable situation. However, if we have to achieve this, you can understand that right now, whatever is the CO2 emission, which is given in the y-axis, or the CO2 percentage or PPM level in the atmosphere, that should not change. Okay. And if we actually go on doing the business as usual, then the way the CO2 concentration will change in the atmosphere will follow that red line, which is RCP 8.5. That means by the end of the century, we will have 1200 ppm of CO2 in the atmosphere. That will increase the temperature of Earth's surface by 3 to 5 degrees. And that means a total disaster will come. All the big cities which are near the seashore or near a big river will be submerged, and many other issues will come up, as you might be already knowing. So in order to achieve the 1 to 2 degrees Celsius temperature increase, we have to follow a path where the atmospheric CO2 concentration will remain almost the same. Okay, and that is what we call as net neutrality, because then in that case, we are not allowed to release any further CO2. So you can understand that that's a big challenge. We'll describe this challenge a little bit more in this particular slide. There is a discussion that we must achieve this net neutrality by the mid of this century. So why is that? This CO2 concentration right now in the atmosphere is about 415 ppm. It has been calculated by the scientists that in order to achieve that 1 degree pathway or 2 degree pathway, we can at most allow 450 ppm of CO2 in the atmosphere. That means we have still a buffer of about 35 ppm. And it is understood that this 35 ppm, this gap of 35 ppm will be covered within a couple of decades only. So after 2050, we are not allowed to emit any further CO2 from any sources, be it a car, be it industry, or anywhere. So this is what the net neutrality is all about. We are doing our business as usual, but no CO2 is going to get to the atmosphere. And that we must achieve by 2050. Now let us come down to the steel sector, about which we are going to talk today. The challenges for net neutrality, what are the challenges? The major challenge in India is in the steel sector is its growth potential. If you see the left hand side graph, actually it talks about, if the steel industry take the changes gradually, they change their processes, but not in a drastic manner, but very, very slowly. What will happen is we'll still have worldwide increase in the steel production, which is shown in this particular graph. Y-axis is the production and x-axis is the year. If you see a little dip into this particular graph, you will see that this yellow band over here is actually representing the Indian production, and that is increasing in a big way over the years. Whereas this greenish band over here is from China, where the steel production is definitely going to shrink. The same scenario will also remain if the steel industry adopt the changes in a big way, which is called the SDS scenario or sustainable development scenario. There as well, the Indian steel production is going to increase in a great speed, whereas China is going to go down gradually and the rest of the world will remain constant mostly. So as you produce more and more steel, you produce also more and more CO2. So that's why the challenge for India to achieve the net neutrality is very, very difficult, particularly for the steel industry. Let's go to the next slide now and try and see that the CO2 problem, how it is associated with the steel industry. What are the different sources of CO2 and what are the numbers which are very important? If you see the left-hand side picture over here, we are showing a blast furnace, where generally it will take about 0.4 billion tons of coke and 0.22 billion tons of coal to produce 1 billion ton of crude steel. If we produce 1 billion ton of crude steel, we will produce 2.5 billion ton of CO2, so which is quite large, and that will be released to the atmosphere. Now, how large is 1 billion ton of CO2? Okay, we talk about billion tons of CO2, but it's a gas. So let us try and understand that how big is this 1 billion ton of CO2. So to store this 1 billion ton of CO2, we would require, in, of course, atmospheric pressure, we would require about 225,000 Olympic-sized swimming pools. Or if we want to get this absorbed by different plants, like it always does due to the photosynthesis, we have to grow 2,750 square kilometers of red forest. So you can understand that this is an Herculean task. This CO2 is really, really large. And for India, which is having about 110 million ton production per year, you can understand this all numbers are going to get multiplied. So that is why the steel industry have to be extremely serious and need to work on this on war footing. Okay. Now, where is this CO2 comes from within a steel industry? Okay, this is we are going to examine in this particular slide and the subsequent slides. In this slide shows in the right-hand side picture is actually the picture of blast furnace. Okay, this is where the iron is being made. In the left-hand side pie chart, we are showing different units in a steel company, which is starting from, say, which are not really starting from, but which is having steel making units, the caster, the rolling mills, the coke making units, sinter making unit, and the blast furnace. So if you see, the blast furnace is responsible for about 70% of the total emission in a steel plant. So that actually tells us that where to concentrate our effort to reduce CO2 in steel industry. And what is the source of this huge amount of CO2 in the blast furnace? The source is actually the carbon-based fuel, which is either coal, coke, or some kind of oil sometimes. And how much we produce CO2 per ton of steel? As you know, that already 2.5 tons of CO2 per ton of steel. So this is the scenario in a traditional steel plant which is using the blast furnace. However, there is a way of reducing it greatly if we use the directly reduce iron or DRI technologies. The schematic is given over here. Here the iron is produced in the form of lumps, not really liquid iron, but form of lumps or DRI it's called. And this particular unit does not use coke or coal, but it uses natural gas. If it uses natural gas, then the specific CO2 emission becomes from 2.5 to 1.4 ton of CO2 per ton of steel. So that's a big reduction, okay? However, what are the issues here? Why India cannot adopt it right away? It is because the overnight change in the technology is not really economically viable for us, because India in last few decades, because of its increase in the production of steel, has invested a lot in blast furnaces. So we cannot really change everything overnight. That is number one. The number two is that we do not have sufficient amount of natural gas in India. We have to anyway export it from other countries, and it's not very easy. And also we need to have a proper distribution network. That is also not ready with us. But there's a lot going on in India. The government is also working, and we probably will have higher percentage of natural gas coming into the steel plant as fuel. But still, the blast furnace will remain. That means CO2 emission will also be there in steel industry for many years to come. Now, what are the third way of steel making? It is the electric arc furnace route. I shall not go into details, but it reduces further the CO2 emission, okay? And depending on what you are using in that electric arc furnace as the charge mix, you will get different amount of CO2 going into the atmosphere, which is given in the right-hand side table over here, which, as you can see, varies from 0.2 to about 1.9 to 2 tons of CO2 per ton of crude steel. However, there is also a big challenge for India to adopt this technology completely. Why? What it is? What is that? That is, we still do not have quality scrap supply. In Europe and in the US, it is still available, but in India, it is not available as much as we want. The second problem is that the steel that is used is actually used the EAF route. That might not always be very suitable for automotive grades, or, and for that matter, some other grades of steel as well. So that's why there is a limitation up to which we can adopt the electric arc furnace route for steel production. I hope up to this level it is a little clearer that we just discussed about the problems that we have in steel industry, and now we shall try and see what are the approaches that a steel company or Tata Steel particularly has taken up in order to reduce the CO2 emission. We shall start from the bottom of this particular page. The first way is to adopt different technologies to reduce the carbon carbon in the source, which is called carbon direct abundance. Which means that means what? As we have discussed just now, that the iron making units generally uses coal, coke, or natural gas as the fuel. However, if we gradually replace that coal and coke with hydrogen, or if not hydrogen, with some other gases which carries or having a lot of hydrogen in it, then at least the CO2 emission will reduce. It also means that we require to have hydrogen generation units within the steel companies, because unless we have hydrogen, there is no question of using it as fuel. But what type of hydrogen we must have? So this is also a very important question that we must ask ourselves. Currently, the hydrogen generation uses a technology called SMR, or steel methane reforming. That particular method itself emits a lot of CO2. So it means that if we generate hydrogen through that route and use it for reduction of CO2 in the industry, that means we are just putting our problem in another person's basket. So the hydrogen suppliers, then you will actually generate more and more CO2, and that is not going to solve our problem. So the hydrogen has to be green. That means the hydrogen, whatever way we produce, it should not emit a lot of CO2. The third option is the carbon capture and sequestration, or use. It means that whatever we do, as we have just discussed, probably the cutting of CO2 at the source completely will never be possible. So whatever CO2 that we are emitting, that could be captured and that could be stored somewhere or sequestrated or could be used. So that could be the third way of attacking this problem. Now, this we shall discuss further in the subsequent slides, and how we approach and what are the different limitations that we have in all the three approaches. Okay. So, as I said, that the CO2 can be reduced in a blast furnace or in steel making by introducing, let us say, hydrogen bearing gases. How much is it beneficial? Let us have a look at that. So, you see, the present case scenario is the blast furnace and basic oxygen furnace route, and we emit about 2.5 tons of CO2 per ton of crude steel. However, if we inject hydrogen or natural gas in the blast furnace, then this specific emission will come down to 2.3 ton of CO2 per ton of crude steel. So that's not a large reduction, but still a reduction. And that is important for steel industry. Now let us see what happens when you inject, let us say, hydrogen or natural gas in a blast furnace. Okay. So this left hand side graph actually tells us what happens in a simulator. Okay. Let me start from the blast furnace, the picture of the blast furnace here in the right hand side. Now, I'll not go into the details, but let us say that from the top of the blast furnace, we put the ores, the solid material, the ore and the coke. And from the bottom, we actually pass on the hot air. As you can understand, that it's a counter current flow kind of a scenario. And this ore actually gets reduced to iron, but it starts from a solidified condition and end up in liquid iron at the bottom. So somewhere in between, there is a massy phase. Okay. And this particular massy phase zone is shown over here in yellow, is called the cohesive zone. This cohesive zone actually plays a big role in blast furnace to improve its productivity, or for that matter, the movement of the gas and the solid. The thinner this particular cohesive zone is, better it is for production. Now, this is the scenario our iron making group has simulated in a small simulator. And as you can see, the left hand side graph, the x-axis here gives the sample temperature, of course. The y-axis gives the differential pressure. And what happens is that if we do not inject any hydrogen bearing gases, The change in the pressure actually follows this path. Okay, so you can see it here. However, if we increase the natural gas injection or hydrogen bearing gas injection, then the pressure, the differential pressure becomes follow the this path. So it tells us that if we use more and more hydrogen bearing gases, then the cohesive zone actually thins down. And if it thins down, then the movement of the gas becomes better. As a result, the productivity of the blast furnace also increases. That is an additional advantage apart from the CO2 reduction that we achieve by injecting such gases. So the technology in this particular subject is being now developed. Of course, the natural gas injection is common. It is there in different blast furnaces already. But hydrogen injection has its own safety problems and other issues, which we are trying to handle right now. So the short-term mitigation plan by 2030, what we need to do, as we understood, that we require, the steel industry require a large quantity of hydrogen-bearing gases. Why I'm saying hydrogen-bearing gases? Because production of such large quantity of hydrogen by that time, green hydrogen, might not be possible. So the key points here to achieve that short-term mitigation is the decrease the dependencies on blast furnace, more use of scrap, introduction of DRI iron making process with natural gas or syn gas, and the injection of hydrogen-bearing gases in blast furnace. So these are the 3-4 items which are there in Tata Steel's agenda for the short-term period by 2030 to reduce the CO2 emission as much as possible. However, this does not take us to the neutrality. So let us now discuss with the difficult problem of neutrality. I hope, because you can understand, I cannot see you people properly because I'm presenting here. So I hope you are all with me, and I am in a slide which is having a title of Towards Carbon Neutrality. If anybody could tell me, please.
Yes.
Okay, I'm audible, right?
I see the towards carbon neutrality side.
Yeah. Okay. Okay. So, in order to have this neutrality, we have to do two things. One, we have to have zero emissions from the iron making units, and we have to generate or adopt technologies which will tell us how to do carbon capture and utilize it. Now you can ask me a question that why not sequestration? Because in Europe, in many countries, the sequestration or many steel plants are trying for sequestration. Sequestration means what? Collecting the carbon dioxide from the blast furnace of gas, and then putting it into some kind of a storage, natural storage. Natural storage platform where the CO2 will remain forever. Now, deep sea wells are quite common for such purposes, but unfortunately in India, such kind of geographical locations are not available. So that's why for us, sequestration is not an option probably. Only option is carbon capture and utilization. So we'll discuss about it. Okay, so the two major challenges are the production of economically viable green hydrogen and the development of technologies for carbon capture and use. Sequestration, as I said, probably will not be possible in India. Okay, so this graph may be a little busy but very important, so please look at it carefully. In the x-axis of this graph, we are showing the hydrogen use is in different iron making units. Okay. In the y-axis, we are showing the specific CO2 emission per ton of crude steel. And all these, the circles inside are actually showing different technologies of iron making. Okay. Now let us concentrate and of course the black color shows that the technology readiness level of that particular technology is very high, that means it is already in operation. The gray, where the TRL is about 6 to 7, and this orange where the TRL is about 4 to 5. TRL is technology readiness level. Okay, so let us go one by one. So in the left hand side upper corner, we are seeing there are few technologies written. So Corex, Pynex, and BF is blast furnace. So as you can understand that as it is, the way the technology is right now existing, they don't take much of hydrogen actually. Okay? There is no provision of putting hydrogen there. And the emission is hovering around 2.2 to 2.5 over here. This other area, which is talking about new technologies actually with low TRL level, HySarna, HySmelt, TechNod, ITMK3, etc. They also do not take a lot of hydrogen. That means that although these technologies might have other advantages, but the CO2 emission will not be achievable through these loops. Blast furnace, of course, this gray ball over here, the gray circle over here shows us that it can take some hydrogen, as we have discussed, and the emission will come down to about maybe about between 1.8 to 2 ton per ton of steam. So there is less hope with these technologies, frankly speaking. However, we have also discussed the DRI units, which where the emission level is already quite low, which is between 1.4 to 1.5. These two are the similar technology supplied by two different companies, Midrex and HYL or Tenova. They can take a lot of hydrogen. Currently also they are taking about 50 to 60% hydrogen in the current process that they have. They can take 95% hydrogen as their fuel mix. And if they do that, the CO2 emission comes down to almost zero. So this is one viable technology which is available right now in large scale, where the CO2 emission from iron making unit in steel industry could come to a near zero level. So this is where many of the steel industries are pinning their hope on. So who are the people who are working on this actually? In Europe is actually far ahead of any other place in on earth to achieve or to take these technologies forward. Hybrid is a consortium, which is actually a Swedish consortium, which has got three companies with them, Vattenfall, LKAB and SSAB. And they are already in pilot scale producing steel with hydrogen as their fuel. And they said that they will achieve the hydrogen steel making by 2035. Salfos is another area, another consortium who are working in Europe. It is actually with Salzgitter and HKL technology is working, or the Tenova is working with them, and they said that they will phase out all their blast furnaces by 2050. ArcelorMittal is also working with Midrex to use hydrogen in their DRI units and reduce their carbon emission to zero. However, all these different people are working in the pilot scale now at different stages, but Hybrid has advanced quite a bit. Now, let us come down to the hydrogen generation technology. What are the technologies available and which one India should adopt? So here there's a graph. Again, the x-axis shows us the TRL level. The y-axis shows the CO2 emission for the hydrogen that we produce. Okay, it is very important. So we should actually go from the left top corner to the right bottom corner. That is how the expectation or the desire of the steel industry would be. Now, here you can see there are different technologies. There is three color also you can see. And please remember that the hydrogen all over the world are told to be having three colors. One is gray. That means it emits a lot of CO2. There is blue, which is not emitting a lot, but still emitting quite a bit. And the green, where there is no electricity, CO2 is emitted for hydrogen production. Now, here, the size of the circle talks about how much from one unit hydrogen could be produced. The larger the circle, the size of the circle, larger is the possibilities of getting hydrogen from one particular. What are the different considerations, by the way? So the considerations are, it has to be green hydrogen, it has to be large in volume because steel industry requires it in large quantity. The technology should be high in readiness level, and the cost should be as low as possible. Now in this, as I'll not go into details of this because we kind of run different calculations and come down to this particular graph, but let us say that there are three technologies that Tata Steel is actually putting their our hope on. Okay, so what is the what is called CLC or chemical looping combustion? This is a joint work that we are doing with Ohio State University, where we are going to use the blast furnace of gas and convert it into hydrogen. There is a similar technology called stepwise. It is in Europe, where also the blast furnace of gases are taken and converted into hydrogen. This is also something that we are looking at. The other one is the biomass gasification. Now, in biomass gasification, there is, of course, hydrogen does not come in very pure form, but you do not require also very pure hydrogen. And we'll discuss this in the next slide. But one thing I want to mention here, that although we all talk about electrolytic or the electrolysis to be used as the generation of as the technology of hydrogen generation, but please remember, if that electricity comes from the grid, the way the grids are right now in India, it is not green technology at all. It is actually then becomes a gray technology, as you have shown it over here. So to hydrogen to be green from electrolysis, the electricity has to be green. Gradually, of course, India is increasing its share of solar in the grid. As and when it comes, this electrolysis will be also quite an important technology for us. The other smaller disadvantage that electrolysis has actually is that it's smaller. One particular unit is small in terms of the production of capacity of production of hydrogen. So that also we need to take care of in future. So what are the different targets that we have? The cost of the hydrogen has to be less than $0.5 per kg of hydrogen. Okay. The volume, as you can see here, that we actually are going to have some hydrogen by 2022, which is about 2 tons per day. By 25, it is 25 tons per day, and by 2050, we would require about 600 tons of hydrogen per hour if we have to have the carbon neutrality. The location, we actually want that hydrogen plants to be co-located. Otherwise, the transportation of such large amount of hydrogen would be a problem. The carbon footprint of that hydrogen has to be less than 5 kg per kg of hydrogen. Of course, that is different. The purity, and here is another important thing. You must have heard about fuel cell, etc., where extremely high purity hydrogen is required. But for steel industry, it is about 80% purity, which would be enough. But we do not want any nitrogen, CO2, or sulfur in that gas mixture. That means we can work with a mixture of hydrogen and CO rather than only hydrogen. Okay. So now let me come down to the production of green hydrogen. Okay. What are the different ways, as I described, and what are the, you know, the different issues with those? So there are three ways, as I told, that there is the first way is the chemical looping combustion, as we described in the previous page. I'm sorry, I forgot to put the title over. Chemical looping combustion, where the capex or the capital investment is not known because the technology we're developing along with the partners. The carbon footprint here is about 5.5 kg. If we use biomass, okay, then what happens? The capex is about, I have not put that particular number, I'm sorry guys, because this is, we are also working with another partner of ours where we are developing something jointly. So let us say that it is X. But the carbon footprint you see, it could be actually negative. Now, minus 17 kg, we have done some modeling and came up with this number. It could be here and there. But actually, if you use biomass for generation of hydrogen, probably the source itself, you are reducing CO2. Because that biomass, if you left it out for just for burning, as you all know in India happens a lot, or for that matter, if it naturally degrades, it generates GHG or the greenhouse gases. So in the source itself, we can cut down. However, if we adopt the electrolysis process, then the capex or the capital investment becomes 14 times of that of the biomass loop. So that's a problem for electrolysis. The capex is very high. The CO2 footprint, if we take the grid electricity, is huge. 29 kg per kg of hydrogen. However, if the grid electricity is available, then there is no CO2 footprint for production of hydrogen at all. So these are the considerations with which we are progressing. Now, let us go a little bit deeper into this. Okay. So to produce 1 million ton of hydrogen through an electrolyzer, we require 60 million megawatt of electricity. Why there is still a hope for us? Because 40% of India's electricity is said to be actually its green level by 2030. So that means at least this CO2, this hydrogen that you generate will not be very gray. It could be somewhere between green to gray, actually. For the chemical looping combustion, we require about to produce 1 million ton of hydrogen, we would require some amount of coke oven gas, amount of blast furnace gas, and we have that in plenty. All steel plants actually have. So we may make use of this in a big way. Let us talk about biomass. To produce 1 million ton of hydrogen from biomass, we require 13 million ton of biomass. It may sound a huge quantity, but if you see that in India, there is 620 million ton of crop residue produced every year. And 100 million ton of that crop residue, we burn every year. And just by burning, we produce 150 million ton of CO2. So the biomass route is also quite attractive for India. However, there is a problem. That the supply chain of biomass, because the biomass is being generated in the forests, in different agricultural fields. So it has to be carried to the area where these hydrogen generation plants are there. Or the steel plants themselves will have to grow forest for the use of, to be used as biomass for hydrogen generation. But biomass is a very viable route. So Tata Steel is also trying to see that how we can make use of it. Okay, so if we use hydrogen, then how does it work? Okay, let us quickly see that. I'll try to finish up within 10 to 12 minutes. Okay, so if left-hand side picture, you have already seen that to produce 1 million ton of steel, we produce 2.5 million ton of CO2. We use a lot of coke and coal. However, if along with slightly lesser coke and coal, if we also use 15,000 or 16,000 tons of hydrogen, then 1 million ton of steel could be produced with a footprint of 2.3, which is again in terms of CO2. It also saves the coke. As a result, there is a save in terms of the cost of the coke, and that is important for India because the metallurgical coal is actually all imported from abroad. So if you can make use of our own biomass, produce hydrogen, use it in terms of in place of coke, then it could be quite useful for us in the future. Of course, as you know that if you use the route of DRI route, then we require right now a particular amount of natural gas to produce 1 million ton of crude steel. we will end up in emitting 1.56 billion tons of CO2. However, that 1 billion tons of crude steel could be produced in DRI unit by employing about 64,000 tons of hydrogen. And the emission will come to almost zero, which is very, very attractive. And that's what I think the whole world is moving towards. Particularly in Europe, this is going to become very, very, this is becoming popular. Okay. Now, what about the carbon dioxide capture and utilization? If you utilize, how should we utilize? So, as we have seen basically, that you know, if a large steel plant, let us say, by 2050, produce about 85 million tons of crude steel, then after injection of hydrogen in blast furnace, having some amount of DRI, iron making, etc., we still will emit about 1.02 ton of TCS per, ton of CO2 per ton of crude steel. That tells us that about 87 million tons of carbon dioxide will still be there to be captured and utilized, which is a huge task, by the way. Now, we did a calculation, and that is shown in this graph over here, that, you know, what are the different, what are the potential of different technologies or different products, not really technology, but different products we must try to produce from this captured CO2. Okay. And there we found that a different alcohol, either methyl alcohol or ethyl alcohol or bioethanol, is having the maximum number. Okay. The exact y-axis actually tells us the potential to be used as the product which we produce from the CO2. Now, we shall just concentrate on these two products and try and see that how this alcohol could be used or how it is produced and what are the different problems there. Okay, I'll just do a customary check again. So I'm in a slide which is having a title, How Can Hydrogen Help in Decarbonizing Steel Industry, CCU. Can you see? Can anybody tell me, please?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Okay, so as you can understand that the ethanol or methanol is actually a hydrocarbon. So that means that it requires some amount of CO2, it requires some amount of hydrogen to produce these alcohols. Let us say that 1 billion ton of CO2 we have captured. And by the way, I have not mentioned about how to capture, but there are standard technologies for capturing CO2, which is the amine-based technology. Tata Steel also have a small pilot for that. So let us say that capturing is done, okay? So 1 billion ton of CO2 is captured. That if you want to convert to methanol, CH3OH, then we require about 0.14 billion ton of hydrogen. So that has to come from some source, which has to be a green source, by the way. And then we can call this particular methanol to be a green product. For ethanol production, 1 billion ton of CO2 if we capture again, then we would require 0.23 billion ton of hydrogen. But the problem here is that we also require some amount of carbon monoxide. Now, the blast furnace gas is actually also have a lot of carbon monoxide in it. But generally, you know, the steel plants are not willing to let this carbon monoxide go for any other purpose because they burn it to produce power, or they burn it to, you know, in different heating furnaces. So that is one small issue with the ethanol production, okay? And that we have to take care of in the future. Now, this is a busy slide, but I'll request you to concentrate here because this will tell us what are the additional points that we must consider before we choose any technology for the carbon capture and utilization. So here we are discussing only about the methanol production, okay, first. And in the top of it, you can see there's a formula written CO2, H2, which produces the methanol and some amount of water, okay. Now let us imagine that this CO2 is coming from the captured CO2, which is from the blast furnace. Now, if you do that, let us say that E4 is the amount of CO2 that you capture. So that is what you are emitting, right? Because this amount of CO2 will go inside this methyl alcohol or methanol. But in the process of capturing CO2, you will have to put some power. You will spend some power. So that means some amount of CO2 is going to be emitted in the process, which is say E1. So the total the footprint over here is E1 minus E4. E4 you have already going to consume, but E1 you have the extra amount of CO2 that you have produced. Now, let us say that you are producing hydrogen through electrolysis. As we all know that electrolysis will also have some footprint because electricity has to be there. Let us say that footprint is about E. So that means that to produce this hydrogen, you have already emitted E2 amount of CO2. Now, methanol, as you are aware, as chemical engineers, that it was slightly high temperature and pressure. So that also have to spend some energy, and energy means CO2. Let us say that E3 is the amount of CO2 that we produce through this route. Okay, so then what is the total amount of CO2 that is produced in this whole process? It is E1 plus E2 plus E3 minus E4. If this is a negative term, then it should be okay, right? Because then total CO2 is going down, coming down. However, there is a catch, because after you produce the methanol, it is not that you are just keeping it. No, you are going to use it. Okay, let us say that you are using it, which is the way China is using nowadays, that you are mixing it up with gasoline. Okay. However, there is a problem. The problem is, as soon as you use this ethanol, methanol in the gasoline, and the gasoline is burned, all the CO2 that you have captured here from the blast furnace is going to come out. So that this E4, the benefit of that E4 will not remain there. However, what is the benefit that you will get? You will get a benefit because from the mixed gasoline emission will be lesser than the pure gasoline. Okay, which is, let us say, delta E. Then what is the total overall carbon footprint is E1 plus E2 plus E3 minus E4 and then plus E4 because you have already emitted that CO2 and minus delta E. So now, if you see that this term over here, E1 plus E2 plus E3 minus delta E has to be negative. So this is how you need to calculate, and here the chemical engineers actually play a big role, and I'm going to describe a little bit more that what role you could play here. So see, how to do this, how to make this negative actually. All this positive term over here has to be minimized, okay? And how do you do that? E1, which is the carbon capture, you have to work on these amines basically, so that you can have the efficiency in such a level that you don't have to spend a lot of energy to capture. E2, which is coming from the green hydrogen production, there is a lot of work going on. Of course, we have described a few processes, but everywhere there is a possibility of increasing the efficiency. The E3, which is the methanol generation actually footprint, there a lot of work can be done in order to generate different catalysts to reduce the temperature and pressure requirement for production of methanol. So this is where the work of the chemical engineers and the chemists comes into picture, particularly in case of this catalyst development, where a lot of emphasis is being given. Now, this was the use case for methanol as fuel. However, what happens if we do not use it as fuel, but use it for making chemicals like, say, formaldehyde or glycol? Then you will see here, the total term becomes E1, E2, E3, which is all plus, and minus E4. Because in that case, the captured E4 or the CO2 is not going to come out because you are not burning that methane. So depending on the use, the calculation also become different. So that's why the life cycle analysis of the product becomes very important here, where you could play a big role. Okay, so I think I am just coming down to the concluding remarks here. So the heavy industries, as you have just seen, the steel industry needs large quantity of hydrogen. The CO2 problem. It's it's the about which is very important here. The hydrogen required in this process need not be very pure, but it needs to be green. The scale up is the major focus at this moment because everybody is working on different pilots. Tata Steel is also working on pilots, but we need to work on the scaling up of these technologies. Use of biomass, as I have put in the earlier slides, is going to be very important, I think, for India. Capturing CO2 and making useful products out of it will be extremely essential. So not only you use different technologies to reduce the CO2 emission at the source, but you also have to capture CO2 and utilize it in different products. That is going to be essential for carbon neutrality. And we require to have catalyst or membrane technologies to be developed for different purposes. I have put one purpose over here, but there are different purposes, and that is where the people like you could play a very big role. So as guys, you can understand that there is a team who has worked alongside in different groups in Tata Steel. There are some names over here. Dr. Sarkar is the head of our environment research group. Shamik, Dr. Nag is the head of our iron making research group. Origin is senior researcher in Ferroalloys research group. Shantanu is senior researcher in environment research group. Sujan is the researcher, senior researcher in iron making research group. Pritesh is also a senior researcher in iron making, and Chalamuri is working in iron making. They all actually are working in this and trying to chart a pathway for Tata Steel for the carbon deal. Thank you very much. So I don't know whether you could, I hope you could hear me today, because last day there was a problem. If there is any question, we can have a few questions.
So thank you to Sandhu for that very good talk, and let us have the questions for him. Professor Harry. Yeah. Yes.
Thank you for the excellent lecture. I learned a lot. Is Tata Steel abandoning Pulsana? Would lead to
Yes. So Harry, Tata Steel is very seriously working with Hazarda. However, as I told, that Hazarda is not really a lot about the CO2 emission reduction, but it is about using the very low quality raw material and still produce good quality of steel out of it. But there is a small catch here. The catch is, it can still be useful from the point that for blast furnace gas, the emission that we have is a mixture of CO gas, CO2 and hydrogen and nitrogen. Okay, CO and CO2 is about 25% each, and nitrogen is about 50%. Hydrogen is very, very less in amount. So when we want to capture CO2 from this gas, it becomes very difficult because of the presence of other gases. So the capture actually requires much more resources and much more, cost. However,
yes. So isn't the point? Isn't the point that you don't need to do any sintering or use coke? So you save 20% CO2 because you eliminate all that part of the process.
So Harry, definitely the sintering is not required, but the coal, the not really metallurgical, but the coal has to be used, and
you save energy by not pelletizing and sintering and so forth, and you save about 20% of energy. That means 20% of CO2.
Yes, and there is a small catch here. In case of our blast furnaces, the coke rate is about, say, 300 kg per ton, and the coal rate is about, say, 220. That means in total, we spend carbonaceous fuel about 520 kg per ton of iron. However, for Hisarda, it could be higher. And that's okay. Why, but there is a catch, Harry. Catch is that the CO2, the gas that we emit here is very pure in terms of the CO2 content. It is almost 80 to 90% CO2. That means the capture cost becomes very low. So that is one big advantage. And in the future, there is a chance that we'll also try and use some amount of natural gas in Hisarda. In that case, come down.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you.
Questions from the students? It's a very relevant topic given what we are going through in climate change and how there is a need to get a neutrality in carbon dioxide. So I want the students to ask more questions. Students, please ask questions.
Sir?
Yes.
Sir, is there any way to incorporate non-conventional sources to heat up the blast furnace, sir?
So, what do you mean by non-conventional sources?
Like, we can use the nuclear power or we can use even the microwaves.
See, microwave is used for different purposes. In fact, Tata Steel is also using for coke making. However, you have to understand the process of blast furnace. As I told you, that it's a counter current flow. So from the top, you have iron ore and the coke charged. And from the bottom, you are actually pushing the gas or the air, practically hot air. Now, what happens is in the counter current flow, this iron oxide which is there in the ore is getting reduced. Because the coke burns and it gives CO and the CO reacts with the iron oxide. Okay, so it is not about only heating, but it is also about reduction. So the nuclear power is not going to reduce the iron ore, right? Or for that matter, any other. I mean, it is not about heating only. It is about reduction of that iron oxide, which is not going to happen unless you have a reductant. And that's why it is important to have a reductant in the system. Now, the question could be that why can't we use 100% hydrogen? That's a BTEC question, basically. Why can't we use 100% hydrogen in a blast furnace? If I, of course, the metallurgists are aware of this answer, but practically it is because, you know, for the proper descent of the iron ore charged from the top, you require some amount of coke, which will actually burn out and create the pathway for the burden to descend. So that's why in iron blast furnace, we cannot eliminate the coke completely. And that's why the reduction, as I showed to you, is only about 0.2 to 0.3 tons per ton of crude steel that we produce. I hope I have answered your question. The reduction is necessary. That's why you need some coke which also can reduce the iron ore.
Yes, sir. In some places you have mentioned that electricity with zero carbon dioxide emission. Are all of the sources pertaining to the renewable energy sources, or is there any other technique?
No, it is only about renewable sources. So if you use solar, for instance, or nuclear or something, anything like that, or wind, then you have green electricity. And it is generally told that that in India by 2030 we can have 30 to 40% green electricity in the grid. So it could be a very different scenario than that case.
Okay.
A lot of challenges, but yes, it is feasible.
Sir, can the technique be used for capturing other gases like sulfur dioxide or something?
So there are different techniques for capturing sulfur dioxide. We are working on, for instance, in the blast furnace gas, as I mentioned, there are four gases actually: CO2, CO, nitrogen, and little bit of hydrogen. Now, currently, the technology is available for separating out CO2 from this, which is an amine-based technology. However, if we could also separate out the nitrogen, it is going to be extremely useful, because then we are left with only CO and hydrogen, which is very useful gas for even blast furnaces, or for that matter, for DRI units. So what is important in the context of my lecture is to, if we also can work out a process for separating out nitrogen from this mixture. Now, there are other techniques for separating sulfur dioxide, for instance, as you asked. In fact, I must mention that all the sulfur containing gases, which is there in the blast furnace, very little in ppm, but that actually we are separating out or taking out from the stream before we put that whole mixture into the amine column, which is there in Tata Steel right now. We are currently commissioning that particular plant. It's very important that we take out the SO2, and there are different processes of separating out SO2 or any sulfur bearing gases.
Sir, which amine do you use for it, sir?
So the amine, actually it is the confidentiality that the suppliers maintain. Different people have different amine, actually. So and that is their trade secret. By the way, who are the people here? There is BASF supplies this amine. I think Mitsubishi also does it. There is Carbon Clean Solution, and there is also technology from Shell, and so on and so forth. Yes, I think we, Dr. Mohan, I think we have exhausted all the questions. So,
very exhaustive and wonderful presentation, Saurabh. Thanks so much.
Hi. Sorry. I have not noticed you, Professor Mitra. Thank you for your comments.
So, means I knew that last day there was some goop up, but then I was talking to Anand. In a way, I was extremely happy because I missed out your last day's presentation, but I could be present today. Okay. So we'll talk to you later in more details. Thanks so much again on behalf of the department. Okay, I have to leave for another meeting. Kindly excuse.
Thank you.
Thanks for the comments.
Yeah, thanks so much. Great day, everybody. Bye.